Jamie Beer. I'm the online campus pastor, and I am so glad you are with us today and you're joining us for church. I want to start off and I want to share with you a story. This is Brenda's story. Okay, you ready? The ability to do church online has been such a blessing. For various reasons, I was only able to attend in person once during a six-week period. Being able to get up at Sunday morning, grab a cup of coffee, and log in at 10:30 to attend church kept me connected in a way I otherwise wouldn't. I was able to read your chats and reply in real time. Words can't relate just how important that is to me. Thank you for all the hard work you put into keeping us connected no matter where we are. I just want to say that this is why we do church, right? We want to keep you guys connected to Summit no matter where you're at. If you want to be like Brenda, you want to share your story, you can email mystory@mysummit.church. Okay, we're going to switch it over and we're going to receive tithes and offerings.
God is a God who loves to bless. And you know who God blesses? The obedient. Hey, in the back at the door, we can hear you guys. It'd be great if we could all hop into the service mode. God blesses those who live in obedience. Because just like you as a parent, you don't bless your kids for disobeying, right? You don't reward them for disobeying. Listen, if you don't listen to mommy and daddy all day long and you disobey everything, you're going to get a big treat tonight. But we want God to bless us when we've lived in disobedience all week long. And so I'm a believer that when we fall into a rhythm of obedience with God, He falls into that rhythm of blessing us, favoring us, prospering us. And so I just want you to let that lead you in how you obey God in everything, not just in giving. Lord, we give you thanks now for the blessings to come in our marriage, in our homes, in our parenting, in our jobs, in our relationships, in our friendships, in our finances, in our mental, spiritual, and physical health. Because, God, you said there's blessing when we obey. So we give you that now, this gift of obedience we give to you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
New Mr. Clean rubs out grime, grease, stains.
Ritz crackers are richer.
Tonight we'll have Tootsie Roll.
Maxwell House Coffee.
And get a great big bottle of Mike.
When a new kind of peanut butter started to appear in...
Have a Coke.
Well, God bless you guys. Good morning. You look awesome. Thank you so much for being here. I know everyone's got big plans today, even though no one truly cares about who's in the Super Bowl, because if you like the Rams, we're going to ask that you just go ahead and make your way out the back right there. But actually, I'm from St. Louis, and the Rams spent some time in St. Louis, and the owner was terrible to us there and really didn't want to be in the city, and so there's a really sour relationship. So I am rooting, not necessarily for the Bengals, but in order to root against the Rams, I have to root for the Bengals. So that's the way it's going to work for me today. But we have something awesome planned today. Not only are we doing the giveaways, every one of you is going to get for Valentine's to show you how much we love you. You're going to get a bag of Popcornopolis sweetened popcorn. I don't even know all the flavors. I think there's a variety pack of flavors, and so we're going to give that away. But we just started a message series last week, What Kind of Church Are We? And it comes out of the idea that, when you invite someone to go to church with you, the first thing they ask is, well, what kind of church is that? What kind of church do you go to? And I don't even know that we know the answer to what kind of church are we. If we were a denominational church, you could say, oh, we're Baptist, or we're Assembly of God, or we're Foursquare, or we're Lutheran. We would have something to go to. But I don't think that even describes who we really are. And so I began the series last week with that we are an unfinished church. And if you haven't seen that, go to the online campus and you can watch it there. But today, I'm really, really proud to have our guest speaker in. And Brad and I have been friends for a long, long time. As a matter of fact, Brad was one of the people who was robbed at gunpoint with me. That's how far back we go and how deep our relationship goes. We shared one of the most traumatic events of our lives together. We both have the pea-soaked stain jeans to show that we were both there together for that. But Brad is truly one of the kindest people I know, one of the most compassionate people I know, and compassion drives him in everything he's done through ministry. He was the pastor of really one of our nation's great churches in the Midwest in Cincinnati, so he's obviously cheering for the Bengals today, but pastored an amazing church for many, many years and only left to do what he's doing now, and I'm going to let him tell you a little bit more about it, but I couldn't think of anyone better to speak on a compassionate heart and what it looks like to be a compassionate people. And as soon as he's done, I want to give us an opportunity to respond compassionately and be a part of something that God's doing in him and through him in the ministry that he's going to share this morning. Would you guys give a huge, huge summit welcome to Brad Rosenberg?
Thank you, Pastor Chris. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I realize that I am in Northern California, and I'm excited about that because if you live in Northern Cal, you pretty much hate everything in Southern Cal, and that's what we need today. There are no Bengals mentioned in the Bible. However, every ram that is mentioned in the Bible is slaughtered. So it's really great to be here and to be able to be with Pastor Chris and Lisa and their amazing family, and they speak so highly of you guys, and it's just, it's truly an honor to get to be with you today. Turn to the person next to you and say, you know what? You look fantastic. Now I want you to turn to the other side and say, how about you taking me to lunch? You know, I want to affirm you guys for being such a compassionate church. There is a core value that I would say is kind of like the thread of my life. And it's simply this, that lost people matter to God, so they better matter to the church. Okay? Thank you, ma'am, right here on the front row. To the rest of you, lost people matter to God, so they better matter to the church. Amen? We understand that there are people not only in this community, but in this entire region and around the world who are outside of God's family, and they need to have the opportunity to hear of the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Amen? And that's what compassion drives us to do. I want to start out by asking you a question, and this is all interactive today. You're going to find that Pastor Chris and I are very similar in our personalities and how we think almost everything in the world is funny. And I want you to interact, you know, feel free to yell out. I spoke in Fresno not too long ago. We got some Fresno people, all right, at People's Church. And I said, if you want to take notes today, you can. If you don't feel like it, you just want to draw a picture of me, that's fine too. And some little girl at the end of the service found the head of security for the senior pastor and said, can you get this picture to the guest speaker? And she literally drew a picture of me during the entire service. So hopefully you'll get something more out of this today. The question is simply this: what is 750,000 miles long at that length that would go around the circumference of the earth 30 times and gross 20 miles every day? Get that concept. 750,000 miles long. It would go around the circumference of the earth 30 times and gross 20 miles longer every day. Does anyone have any idea what that is? That is the line, ladies and gentlemen, if people were lined up shoulder to shoulder, of people who are outside of God's family. And a compassionate church, a church who recognizes that lost people matter to God, so they better matter to us, recognizes that we have to do something about that. How many of you like to be part of the solution this morning? Amen. That's what we're going to do. So my life mission really is to alleviate suffering and populate heaven. My mission this morning is to make sure we can do everything within our power and resources to shorten that line. Guess what it takes to shorten that line? It takes radical generosity. Now, I don't know if you've taken this into account, but there are about 2,300 verses in Scripture that deal with money or possessions. And to give you a reference point, there are about 500 verses on faith and about 500 verses on prayer, and yet there are 2,300 verses about resources and possessions. How many of you would say God has something to say about this? So let's get started. If you have your copy of God's Word, you can turn to this, or I believe it'll be on the screen today as well. Matthew chapter 6 simply says this: "Don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroy them, where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be. No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." You know, one of the challenges is that our culture has everything backwards and upside down. How many of you would agree with that this morning? So culture would say that success is measured by how much I get and how many people are under me in the flow chart. Right? What KPIs are you going to hit this week? What are your goals? What's your boss saying? We got to hit this. We got to hit this. It's about how much I get or accumulate and how many people are under me in the flow chart. And yet God's definition of success is completely upside down. God's definition of success is about how much I give away and how many people I serve. So the challenge then is, how do I live right side up in an upside down world? Because the world and culture's priorities and what God says is a measurement of success are diametrically opposed. That's what we want to talk about this morning. Living a life of generosity, moving, the process of moving from greedy to generous or from stingy to sharing. How many of you have ever had a toddler in your house? Okay, this is really all the lesson you need to know. When you are playing with a toddler in the family room on the floor, what they have in their hand is theirs, and what you have in your hand is also theirs. And so, if we have this within us, it's this process of moving from greedy to generous and from stingy to sharing. And there's a story in the Bible, it's my favorite story, on this concept of sharing. How many of you have a challenge with sharing? You know, tell the truth, shame the devil. There you go. I have a problem with this in one area. It's McDonald's French fries. If my kids try to take one off my tray, they will get a fork in the back of the hand. I'm not sharing those. No, but we're wired where what's ours is ours. And yet there's this incredible story that I'd like for us to quickly go through this morning in John chapter 6. If you want to follow along, that'd be great. I'm going to make you a deal. I got a clock here that's winding down on me. So if you promise to listen fast, I promise to read fast. Deal? All right, here we go. "Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias, and a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the miraculous signs that he had performed on the sick. Then Jesus went up on the mountainside and sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, 'Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?'" Now, I love verse 6. If you're cool with underlining or highlighting in your Bible, do that on verse 6 here, right here. "He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. And Philip answered, 8 months' wages would not be enough to buy even bread for each one to even have a bite.' Another of Jesus' disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up and said, 'Hey, here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far will that go among so many?' And Jesus said, 'Have the people sit down.' There was plenty of grass in that place, and the men sat down, about how many? 5,000. About 5,000 of them. Jesus then took the loaves and gave thanks and distributed to those who were seated, how much? As much as they wanted. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the very first biblical account of the very first Golden Corral. Okay, here we go. "He did the same with the fish. When they had gathered all and all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, 'Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted.' So they gathered them and filled how many? 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. Now, this is a crazy story. I want you to get in the story with me. So we want to fast forward the clock now 60 years. And this kid who gave his lunch to Jesus is now a grandpa. And his grandkids are jumping up on his lap saying, "Grandpa, Grandpa, tell us the lunch story again. You gave your lunch to Jesus and he fed 5,000 people?" Okay, apparently this happens every Tuesday at your work. This is a crazy story. I asked Pastor Chris if I could have a little whiteboard to do a little illustration, and I'm so thankful that he remembered that I was 4'2" and got me the tiniest whiteboard in the region. I may have to get on my knees to write on this, but I won't be getting back up. So here's the question. Are there any school teachers in the room? Really, right here on the front row. Are there any specific math teachers in the room? I know no one would actually like to admit that because, by the way, I ran into my math teacher at Christmas, my algebra teacher from high school. And I said, "Hey, Tom, this is the 35th year in a row I haven't used algebra." Anyway, that's another story. You guys know what he said to me? He said, "You're an idiot in high school and you're still an idiot today." All right, so here we go. This is not a trick question. Let's try this right here. 7, that's what it is in Missouri. Excellent, okay? But how many of you know when God's in the equation, all bets are off? Right? So when God's in the equation, let's try this math problem again. Equals what? 5,000? Who said that? Raise your hand. 5,000. This person here doesn't give a rip about women or children. Why? What does Scripture say? There were 5,000 men. Now let's go conservatively. How many children do you think they were having at that time? Oh, I heard an oh boy on the front row. All right, so how many of you know if we go with 4, we're probably near the 20,000 range? Okay, now, but that's not the end of the math problem, right? What does the end of the story say? 5 + 2 = 20,000. Remainder what? 12 baskets. That's right. Now, this is not a trick question. And I just realized that there's now an actual camera shot of my bald spot, which I'm not happy about. But here we go. All right. How many of you agree with me that this number is smaller than this number? Here's the point. It's a simple point. When God is in the equation, all bets are off. And I can promise you, you want to invite God into your equation. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. Newsflash, he owns the hills underneath the cattle too. Everything is his. Everything that you have is a gift from God. You go, "Well, you don't know how smart I am." Really? Who gave you your brain? Everything we have is a gift from God. And so I want to talk about this quickly. We're going to go through this. And if you want to take some notes, you can. You don't have to. Please don't draw a picture of me. But if you would like to follow along, that'd be great. So here we are. I believe that today will be a miraculous day for Summit Church. Because when we start taking the resources that God has given us and we hold them like this, instead of like this, he gets in the equation, and when he does that, all bets are off. How many of you want God in your equation? Amen. Let's do this. Number one, a miracle always starts with somebody. We could spend all morning reading about the miracles and listening to miraculous stories in Scripture about David and Daniel and Joseph and Rahab and Hosea. God calls someone to obey him, and the rest of the story is history. Number two, miracles happen in the atmosphere of obedience. I'm not going to write this on the whiteboard here, but I do want you to write it on your notes somewhere. It's another equation that I believe is life-changing. It's simply this: God's prompting plus obedience always equals the miraculous. God's prompting plus obedience equals the miraculous. The point is, he was obedient, and miracles happen in the atmosphere of obedience. Number three, when we do what we can, God does what we can't. Now, I've seen various miracles in different seasons of my life. I've seen physical miracles. I've seen financial miracles. I've seen spiritual miracles. I've seen incredible things happen. And here's what it boils down to, number four in your notes. It's all about listening to the prompting and acting in obedience. It's all about listening to the prompting and acting in obedience. How many of you have ever had God either prompt you or speak to you in a certain way, and when you heard it, you were like, oh, you gotta be kidding me. Anybody had one of those experiences? So I pastored for 28 years. I was a lead pastor for 21 years. And there was a guy who called the church, and he got a hold of the receptionist, and he said, hey, I don't go to your church. I've never been to your church, but my son is on life support at the hospital, and they want me to shut the machine off. And I just wanted to know if your pastor would come over and do last rites. Well, number one, I'm not Catholic. Number two, I don't know how to do last rites. Number three, I've never met this guy. The more you hear my story, you're going to go, thank God, Pastor Chris is our pastor. And so I'm literally arguing with why I don't have the time or the energy to go spend it at this hospital with a family I've never met and really don't need to be involved with them. Once again, it's a good time to say thank you, Lord, for Pastor Chris. And but when I hear this from the receptionist, something in my heart says, go pray for this father. So I go to the hospital, I go up to ICU, I walk in, he's on life support, the dad's at the end. I start praying for the father because I look at the monitor and his brain waves are totally flat. He's dead, right? So I say, Lord, I just pray that you would comfort this father, that you would give him strength in this most difficult day of his life. And while I'm praying out loud, the Lord says, put your hand on his head. Now, get this. I have a bad attitude. I don't want to be there. I'm not even praying for the kid. I'm praying for the father because he's gone. And the Lord says, put your hand on his head. Has anybody ever experienced anything crazy like this? How many of you have ever experienced doing the right thing with the wrong attitude? If you haven't, just ask one of your teenagers to take the trash out. It'll be drug across the driveway. There'll be a big liquid stain the whole way. It got to the end, but it was not done with the right attitude. This is what's happening in this situation. So I'm there, right? So I start to put my hand on the kid's head, but I'm still praying for comfort for this father who lost his son, right? So I'm praying and I'm like, Lord, just hold him close to you today. And while I'm praying for the father, this kid sits straight up in bed. Scared me to death. I almost died of a heart attack in ICU. Scared me to death. The father goes, what'd you do? I said, I don't know. The nurse comes running in. She goes, what did you do? I said, I don't know. Honestly, I looked down to see if I was standing on his oxygen tube. Thank God I wasn't. I didn't do anything. Here's the point. God's prompting plus obedience always equals the miraculous. My attitude was wrong. My heart wasn't in it. And I believe that God allowed me to experience that to know with 100% guarantee that I had nothing to do with it and he had everything to do with it. Because when God is in the equation, all bets are off. God's prompting plus obedience always equals the miraculous. Number five, he gave what he had in his hand and he celebrated the miracle the rest of his life. You may be saying, well, you know, whatever I give today, I don't know that it's that much. You know, when you do what you can, God does what you can't. He gave what he had in his hand, and he celebrated the miracle the rest of his life. So when my wife and I were youth pastors in Baltimore, Maryland, we lived 26 miles from our church because, similar to California, we couldn't afford a house anywhere closer to Baltimore. East Coast and the West Coast are the worst for cost of living. Come to Missouri and you'll do just fine. My wife and I, we used to ride together because we worked at the same place, and we do our devotions and prayer time in the car together. And so she'd read a chapter of scripture, and we talk about it, and we pray. These are the good old days when we had the Integrity worship tapes. Yeah. We'll pop a little Don Moen in. You guys know what I'm talking about? Yeah. And so so we'd have a time of worship. So this is happening, right? And while I'm praying, and by the way, if you're driving on the freeway and you're praying, just pray with your eyes open. God does not expect you to have them closed at that time. And so we're doing our devotions, we're praying, we're worshiping, we're talking about God's word. And I just felt like God dropped something in my heart. So I said to my wife, I said, hey, you know what? I think that we're supposed to give $50 to another pastor that was on staff with us and tell him to take his boys out for pizza tonight. And Angie goes, you know, my spirit bears witness with that. I think that's spot on, but I think you need to tell him to take his boys to Chuck E. Cheese. And I'm like, as the spiritual head of this household, okay? And by the way, if you want something worse than coronavirus, go to Chuck E. Cheese, all right? You get over in that skee ball area, you'll get something real bad. So I said, Angie, God may talk to us about giving people a gift to bless them, but God doesn't ever address the issue of Chuck E. Cheese, all right? Let's get that straight. She's like, whatever, that's what I felt. So we get to work. We had to get some more Don Moen in there because we had a little bit of an argument there. And as we get into work, so she calls me at lunch and she says, have you taken the money over to Dave? And I was like, no, not yet. She's like, you better do what God's telling you to do. And I was like, you better get back to teaching. You know, we were about to have another argument, right? And the only reason I didn't want to do it, I was going to do it. It's about, there were seven other pastors on this church staff. I didn't want everybody sticking his head out of the door going, hey, where's my $50? And once it's another time where you go, man, I'm so glad Pastor Chris is our pastor. So this is happening, right? So she calls me at 4:30. We're about to meet up at 5:00. She goes, have you given Dave the money yet? And I didn't want to have an issue with her. So I slid my chair back from the desk so I wouldn't technically be lying. And I'm like, yeah, I'm on my way. So I walk down the hallway and I knock on his door. And I said, hey, Dave, you got a minute? And he's like, yeah, come on in. I said, I don't want this to be weird or wacky or nutty or crazy, but this morning, Angie and I were praying in the car, having our devotional time together, and it just felt like, you know, the Lord was prompting us to do something. And then being the mighty man of faith that I am, I said, and Angie thinks you should take your boys to Chuck E. Cheese. Like, I wasn't going to have my name attached to any of that. Like, that's a whole nother. And he comes around his desk, right? And he kind of sits down and leans back on his desk. And he puts his head down and his glasses slide forward. And he starts crying. And I'm like, Dave, I'm just messing, man. I didn't mean to offend you. He's like, no, you don't understand. And I'm like, what's going on? And he said, today is Joey's birthday. Today's Joey's 9th birthday, my oldest son. And he said, and as I left the kitchen and went into the garage to get in my car to leave, he ran to the door. And the very last thing he said to me was, Dad, is there any way we can go to Chuck E. Cheese for my birthday tonight? When God is in the equation, all bets are off. If God's concerned enough to make sure that a 9-year-old little boy who we didn't even know was having a birthday was going to get to go to Chuck E. Cheese as he requested, how much more does he care for every need you're going through? God's prompting plus obedience always equals the miraculous. Let me give you this final thought. Charity says, you can have the crumbs and the leftovers from my table. But radical generosity says, I want to give you a seat at the table. People of compassion don't just look at people with sympathy. They get into the pain with empathy and say, how can I help you out of this hole? God may not be asking you to feed 20,000 people, but he is asking you to share what you have in your hand. Here are some harsh realities. Did you know that there are 2.4 billion people in the world who live on less than $2.50 a day? We need your help. Did you know that every single day, 22,000 children die from dirty water and hunger-related issues? 22,000 children. Can you even imagine what this means? I put a little picture in here to help us understand how big the number 22,000 is. Did you know that a 747 jet holds about 500 passengers? Imagine, if you would, 44 747 jets going down every single day full of passengers. In a few moments, Pastor Chris is coming to close our time together. But before he does that, you may be thinking, how can I help? You may have a number in your head right now based on what you think you can do. However, I believe that God is speaking to every person in this room right now. And in all my years of missions giving, every time I've come into a service like this, I've thought, you know what? There are really two ways that you can give. You can give logically, which is, you know, I think we have this in our monthly budget. I could do this. Or you give out of emotion. I'm overwhelmed of the thought that children are dying and suffering, and I want to help alleviate that. May I suggest this morning not to give out of logic and not to give out of emotion, but to pause for a moment and say, God, what are you asking me to do? Because God's prompting plus obedience always equals the miraculous. The only challenge is, this has been my experience, whenever I've come into a service like this with a number in my mind, God's number is always bigger than my number. Anybody ever experienced this? And yet, here is the truth. I would rather do God's number with his help than my number by myself. Because when God is in the equation, all bets are off. Albert Einstein said this, "The world is a dangerous place, not because of those who do evil, but because of those who look on and do nothing." We must treat the poor with dignity. I want to close with this story. In 1986, I went on my very first mission trip ever to Caracas, Venezuela. Preached my very first sermon ever. Do you know what I preached on that day? John 3:16. It was the only verse I knew. But check this out. For God so loved the world that he gave. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. This is an incredible opportunity. Venezuela was prosperous. It was thriving. The vegetation was all over the country. There was oil. The boulevard was strong. Now I want you to fast forward to 2018. In 2018, the country of Venezuela completely imploded. In just a few months, 25% of the entire population left the country, mostly men. What was left? Women and children. With no food, with no opportunity, with no money, nothing. The same missionary that I worked with in 1986 is still there today. Here's what's happened. As these women leave from Venezuela to Colombia, there is a concrete bridge on the border. And when you cross that concrete bridge, guys, if you could put that picture up of the red awning, at the end of that bridge is a red awning. It's an umbrella. And as you walk across this concrete bridge, that is the very first thing you'll see on the border. It's the very first thing you'll see. And these women are walking across with a baby on their chest and a toddler in their hands. And as they're walking across, now imagine it, ladies, how many of you take good care of your hair? Your hair is important to you, right? I have a wife and a daughter. But as these women are crossing, do we have that picture, guys? It's a red awning at the end of my presentation. But I want you to be able to see this. And on this picture, you don't have it? Okay. I wish you could see this. We'll email it out to you guys. But there is a cardboard sign. And on this cardboard sign underneath the awning, it says, "We buy hair." And these women who have nothing, who want to give their kids one more meal, will sit down under that red umbrella and have their heads shaved, sell their thick, rich black hair to give their kids one more meal. And you have an opportunity to be part of that solution. When Convoy of Hope found out that this is happening, we got with the same missionary that we worked with in 86, got on the ground, got with our team. And since that moment, we have personally ministered to over 2 million Venezuelans and have provided for them over 30 million meals. Isn't that amazing? You get a chance to be part of that solution. You get a chance right now to have the opportunity to make a difference in someone else's life. But I would like for you, just for a moment, what we like to say is, if we could give one day to change the world, one day of your annual salary, take your annual salary divided by 365, would you be willing to give one day to give these children an opportunity? We are currently feeding over 465,000 children every day around the world in our 2,100 feeding programs. Your one day can change their every day. Would you be willing to be part of the solution this morning? Let's pray. Father, I pray right now that you would speak to us. That, Lord, you would drop a number in our hearts, that you would nudge us, that you would prompt us, because your prompting plus obedience always equals the miraculous. And today we want to be part of the solution. We recognize that everything we have is a gift from you, that you have blessed us, and you have blessed us to be a blessing. So, Lord, I pray that today you would speak to us as individuals. Would you take a moment right now and just say, "God, what are you asking me to do? Would you speak to me today and give God access to your life?"
Amen. We're going to show Brad appreciation in just a minute, but while we're still sort of in this reflective moment, I said two things at the beginning of this message series. One is I wanted to call the message series, "What kind of church are we? And if we're not, we're going to be." And I also said that the church as a whole is made up of you as individuals. And we can't be generous as a church if we're not generous as individuals. I shared a story with you last week how one of our guest service people who's just faithful to the church began their journey of generosity, and they said it wasn't until they began to give above and beyond their tithe. Above and beyond, because that's what we believe, is every believer needs to step into obedience and tithe. Give a gift back to God of what's his as an act of obedience. And then God will call on you in moments like this to do something generous, because you're driven by compassion, because you feel the suffering of somebody else. And so we're going to do two things. We're going to take a one-time offering today for Convoy of Hope. And if you've never heard of Convoy, I encourage you just hop on the web and look them up, because I will tell you that they are literally one of the most reputable organizations that, and Brad, I think I'm right about this. Don't you have donors that give exclusively to cover operational costs so that gifts like this go 100% to, is that right? That's what I thought. That means that every single dollar you give will go to what Brad just described, because there are those who are generously helping take care of operational costs, and most organizations don't have that. So we're going to do a one-time gift today, and there's three ways that you can give. Number one, you can just write a check, do whatever you want. You're going to make it to Summit Church, and we're going to give collectively to this. Or you can go on to PushPay. You can go onto our website, and there's a drop-down menu, and at the very bottom of that drop-down, it'll say Convoy of Hope, and whatever you give to that, we're going to give that, plus the board and I meet in about a week, and we're going to talk about what we're going to do on top of that. And then I want to encourage you strongly to consider what you can do every single month. We rarely bring projects in front of you or missionaries in front of you because, truthfully, I want it to be one of those God-led things. I want it to be someone I have a relationship with, somebody I believe in. We give over to Jessup, to their Hispanic ministry, so that pastors who don't get higher education opportunities in the Hispanic community can get higher education opportunities. We give to things like that. We've supported missionaries that we have relationships. And I'll be honest with you, this is something worthwhile us giving to. And we can do it. I mean, when we did the Every Room project to put security devices in classrooms throughout the Western Placer Unified School District, we were able to raise over $45,000 just of our own to give to that. That's amazing. That's you. That's us being generous. And so I know we can do this. I know we can give and give in a big way. And so we're going to give today, and then I want to really and strongly encourage you to just commit to giving every single month. And if you continue to just use that drop down and hit put that gift, after you've tithed, give that gift to Convoy of Hope, that gift will be separated and sent to Convoy every single month. We're going to pray, and then we're going to ask the ushers to come. If you don't have a check written out or you want to give something in just a few minutes, there's the offering box at the exit door. And then, of course, you can give digitally, which about 75% of you do. You just go online and give. So, Father, thank you for such an amazing word. My heart, God, was stirred. It was softened again, God, towards the suffering of people. I've witnessed those things with my own eyes. It's so unbelievably easy to get back into the culture and the rhythm of our Western lives and forget about the hurt and the suffering that occurs every day across this globe that we could help impact and change with so little sacrifice on our part. So I pray, God, that you move on our hearts to give and to give generously. And we're going to do that now in Jesus' name. Amen. Can we have the ushers come forward? Again, do we have the QR code in the bulletin? Jamie, do you have that? Do you know? We're going to continue to hopefully put the QR code in there. And you can, if you don't know how to use a QR code, just open up your camera app. It is. She's showing me that it is. Open up your camera app. You point it at there. It'll bring up a little yellow thing, and you can actually rob it right off the screen, and it'll take you to our giving link, and just such an easy, convenient way to do it. And if you don't do that today, make sure you get that done this week. What an amazing message. Can you give Brad just a huge gesture of our appreciation for being here?
We have a few key ways to get connected here at Summit. If you've started attending, whether online or in person, within the last year and you have not made it to one of these yet, sign up today for the Welcome to Summit lunch. This gives us an opportunity to get to know you a little bit more, gives you an opportunity to get to know us a little bit more. And who doesn't love free food, right? This is happening March 6th after service at Old Town Pizza. You can RSVP today at mysummit.church or on the app.
Whenever we think about volunteering, we tend to think of it in terms of what we're giving, and we rarely think of what we're getting from it. But I want you to shift your thinking for just a moment and ask yourself this question. If God created you to serve others and you're not doing that,
don't you think you're missing out on what God wants to give you? And of course, the answer is yes. True, you're not created only to serve people at church, but the Bible does say that you are gifted and equipped to serve one another, your brother and your sister in Christ. And there's no better place to do that than right here at Summit. And that's why we're going to have a ministry fair that lasts 3 weekends to give you the opportunity to really explore how God has equipped you and prepared you to serve others, not only so you can give, but so that you can get. Be sure to commit to exploring at least one ministry over the course of these 3 weekends. And I promise you, you're going to get something amazing from God just for doing that.
There's a lot that goes into a Sunday, and we couldn't do it without you.
You pick up donuts, welcome everyone in with love, even those you just met. Work in the office, pass out trays, lead us in worship, keep us safe, show the love of God to our kids. What you do matters. You are valued. So join us on Monday, February 21st, as we roll out the red carpet for our Volunteer Appreciation Gala. There are only 17 spots left. Sign up today at mysummit.church or on the app.
Hi, Summit Woman. We are going on a hike. February 26th, Saturday morning, we are going to meet at the Community Center at 7:30 for a hike in Auburn. I hope you can join us. It's going to be a lot of fun. This is a great time for connection, community, and for our friendships to grow a little bit deeper. Hope to see you there.
We had such a cool time doing church tonight, am I right? We are a responsive church, one that sees what's going on in the world and we respond to it. We respond with the love of Jesus. Now, if you have any questions about God or you just want to chat or you need some encouragement, you can email me at jamie.buer@mysummit.church or you can call the chaplain, Caroline. So what you could do tonight is you can follow us on Instagram, you can subscribe to us on YouTube, and you can like us on Facebook, and that'll keep us connected to you throughout the week. So I hope you have a blessed week, and I'm going to be praying for you. Bye.